الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، صدق الله العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. زر الشيطان Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home, in our last session of Darsa Hadith, a detailed explanation was given with regards to the absence of Sayyidina Uthman bin Affan radiallahu ta'ala from the Battle of Badr, and in conjunction to that, the demise of Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha was also explained, the beloved daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the beloved wife of Hazrat Uthman bin Affan radiallahu ta'ala anha. Scholars have mentioned that when Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha was breathing her last in Madinatul Munawwara, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the companions was engaged in the battle of Badr. So on one side, the Muslims were busy in jihad fi sabilillah, whilst in Madinatul Munawwara, Hazrat Uthman was responsible for Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha, and in Madinatul Munawwara she passed away. Now Sayyidina Uthman bin Affan radiallahu ta'ala anha, as well as other companions also, these were individuals who were well informed with the rulings of Sharia, and therefore immediately, without wasting time, it was a quick burial. Though she was the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Badr is not very far, and news was already coming in Madinatul Munawwara that victory is with the Muslims, and inshallah very soon the Muslims will be returning back. But even then, without wasting time, immediately preparation was done, and Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala knew exactly what the sunnah was, that you don't waste time. And this is the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when a believer, be it a man or a woman, passes away, nobody can hear the words from that mayyit, of course, but the words are qaddimuni, qaddimuni, qaddimuni. When people waste time, it is giving taklif, trouble, to that person who has passed away. And so that mayyit is actually saying, take me quickly, quickly, why are you keeping me here? Walal akhiratu khayrun laka min al-ula. For a Muslim, the hereafter, Jannah, is better than this dunya. So the words we can't hear, but Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has explained, قَدِّمُونِ قَدِّمُونِ, take me quickly, take me quickly. So it's a lot of pain. That mayyit is very anxious. And so Hazrat Uthman bin Affan did not even wait for the coming of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the father, and immediately everything was done. When Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, he stood over the grave of the beloved daughter Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha and made dua, and that was it. So this was the common practice amongst Sahaba Ikram ajma'in. These were people who would not compromise Sharia. Subhanallah. That is why it comes in the hadith that there was a lady who would often come to Masjid Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she would sweep and clean the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One night she fell ill and she passed away. Immediately women gathered, gave her ghusl, the kafan was put on, Sahaba ikram ajma'in carried her to Jannatul Baqi and she was buried. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not even informed. As not to disturb him late in the night, the burial was done. And only the next day Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came again and stood over the grave and made dua for her. And so you will find many ahadith which speak of the importance of quick burial. This is the sunnah and the hukam, the command of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this again is very, very important, especially in the world that we live in today. Alhamdulillah, in the Muslim part of the world, we don't have this difficulty. You know, somebody was saying to me, Maulana, in England, it's quite dangerous to die on a Saturday and a Sunday. It's quite dangerous to die on a Saturday and Sunday because there's no doctors, no permission, and all the documents that you need. And if you were to die on a Friday, most likely you'd probably be buried on a Monday. Wallahu alam, I don't know the procedure. But in a Muslim country, alhamdulillah, immediately, within 1 or 2 hours. And if death comes in Madinatul Munawwara or in Makkatul Mukarrama, within 1.5 hours, everything is done. Immediately, salatu janaza is prayed, even in the night, even in the night. So at any time, alhamdulillah, that man or that woman is not deprived from the blessings of what Allah has stored for her or that individual. And alhamdulillah, this is the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ulama have mentioned that when Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha had passed away, at the same time, another great sahabi was also made shaheed, Hazrat Khunais al-Hamasi radiallahu ta'ala anha. He was made shaheed in the Battle of Badr. This sahabi was married to Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha. And Hazrat Hafsa was the daughter of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. So Hazrat Umar lost a son-in-law who was a shaheed, Hazrat Khunais. And at the same time also Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha had also passed away. So Hazrat Hafsa was a widow, and as was the Arab custom, and with the Sahaba, Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'in, subhanallah, they had this beautiful network. This beautiful network when it came to supporting Muslim women. Not a single woman would be left without a husband for a long period of time. If Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'in knew of a lady who was a widow or a lady who was tagged as a divorcee, immediately Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'in would inform one another and say, yes, my brother, for the sake of Allah, you have to support that lady, you have to support that lady, you make nikah here, you make nikah there. And so there was this network in the Muslim world. Immediately, the women had someone as a pillar of support. Subhanallah. Today, you'll find that a lot of people wish to live in England. Why? Because of the state support that people, that the government offers you. A lady who's, she will actually say to the husband, I don't care, I'll be given a house, I'll be given money, I'll be given everything, the full complete support. In fact, when a child is 18 or 17, and if the father says something to the child will say, look, I've been taught in school that if your father or your mother are not treating you well, then the government will supply and support you with everything, accommodation, money, and whatever you want. Allahu Akbar. And this has happened. This has happened. I was actually telephoned and I had to come to somebody's house, and this girl rang the police reporting the mother and father, who were very, very good people, all of a sudden through internet or some texting, she came in contact with this man who was unknown. subhanallah. And being young, she fell in love with this man. And she is now prepared to sacrifice everything that her parents had done for her. In fact, she calls the police early in the early hours of the morning, reporting the parents, the father, and saying that my father does not allow me to go out with whom I want. Allahu Akbar. So this is the country that you live in, my respected brothers. It is extremely difficult, but our young children don't realize how you are and what you do. Eventually it gets back to you. Eventually it gets back to you and you will suffer the consequences. I remember in class when Mufti Shabir Saab was teaching hadith, a man was pleading with Mufti Saab and saying, Mufti Saab, look, please take my son in Darul Uloom. He won't run out now for the second time, I assure you. So Mufti Saab said, what do you mean you assure me? What guarantee do you give me? He says, I guarantee you the second time it won't happen. He says, why? He says, that is why, because I gave the same trouble to my father. Because I gave the same trouble to my father. And he said that my father dropped me to a madrasa and I ran off also, and then he put me back in, and eventually I completed the course. So I know this is a testing period for me. I've done it to my father, and so my son is doing it to me. This is dunya. Eventually it affects you, and it affects you in a worse way, my respected brothers, because as days pass, you get close to the day of Qiyamah. Allahu Akbar. Sahaba kiram ajma'in were incredible people. So they would support women, and it was not of carnal desire, but it was because for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, concerned father, he looks at Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha and now thinks that, okay, Hazrat Ruqayyah has passed away. Hazrat Uthman needs a wife. My daughter is a widow and she needs a husband. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was a man who would push around himself and everybody would respect him. Hazrat Uthman was a very close friend of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. Today you can't even imagine two friends offering their daughters to one another. You can't even imagine that. That is the world we live in today. But let us open up the lives of Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'in. So Hazrat Umar came to Hazrat Uthman and said, Uthman, I have a proposition to make to you. If you wish, I have Hafsa who is suitable for you, my daughter, and Allahu Akbar, she was suitable for anyone. It comes in her character, إِنَّهَا سَوَّامَةٌ قَوَّامَةٌ. Two words sum everything. إِنَّهَا سَوَّامَةٌ قَوَّامَةٌ. A lady during the day fasts. سَوَّامَة, during the day she fasts. قَوَّامَة, in the night she stands for tahajjud. Can you find a woman like that? During the day she is fasting and in the night she is in tahajjud. Extraordinary woman. So any man would want to marry the daughter of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. And so he came, he said to Uthman, Uthman, what do you think? Hazrat Uthman looked at Hazrat Umar and he said that, give me a few days to think about it. And so Hazrat Umar said, fine, I'll give you a few days to think about it. After the few days, Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an comes to Hazrat Umar Farooq and says, and this is in Bukhari Sharif, that he said, there is nothing wrong with your daughter, subhanallah, she is a wonderful lady. If you propose Hafsa to anyone, nobody would reject her. I don't reject her, but at this moment, I have no intention to take any woman in my nikah. It was a difficult moment. Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's daughter Ruqayya, who he loved dearly, passed away. So immediate nikah was quite difficult. So he said, right now I am not in the mood to take on any woman for that matter in the nikah. So please excuse me from this. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an looked at Hazrat Uthman, accepted it of course, that okay, if you don't want to marry, immediately a concerned father. Now he thinks of his best friend. His best friend. And really they were the best friends. He thinks of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Who better in Medina Munawwara is better for my daughter than Abu Bakr Siddiq? Today we look for, oh, that person, this rich man. You know, women dream to get married to people who are multimillionaires, and men have this desire to have women who are extremely beautiful and what not. Allahu Akbar. But with Sahaba Ikram Ajma'in, it was only one thing. They would look at taqwa and piety and nothing else. Age wasn't a problem for Sahaba Ikram Ajma'in. They were strong people. 80-year-old Sahabi was stronger than a man today who's in his prime age. Women were strong. Subhanallah. A girl who was 9 years of age in the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was as mature as a girl today who is 25. As 25. Why was it that Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha got married to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at such a young age? And the knowledge she gives to the ummah. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. So these were just different people, very mature, very physically very strong people, people who would uphold the sunnah and have the love for the Quran and the teachings of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he came and he said, Abu Bakr, my daughter, I give her in your hand in nikah. Do you accept? Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, a man who's senior, looked at Hazrat Umar, and all of a sudden he just came into this complete muted stance, saying nothing, just stalled on him, just completely stalled on Hazrat Umar Farooq, didn't say anything. Hazrat Umar Farooq is saying, do you want to marry my daughter Hafsa? And Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq is looking at him. Do you want to marry my daughter? Hazrat Abu Bakr is saying nothing. Now, this was quite strange. This was not the character of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. Now, Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala didn't take this well. And so, he returned back and it comes in the hadith, and Muhaddithin have mentioned that he's saying that wasn't Uthman better? At least he gave me an answer. Yes or no? Wasn't Uthman better? At least he gave me an answer. But someone who is like Abu Bakr Siddiq, saying nothing to me, when I give him my daughter for him to make nikah with, and he doesn't give me an answer. Subhanallah, after a few days, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq didn't meet up with Hazrat Umar Farooq after that. Well, meet up in a sense that they did not talk about this. But Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam met with Hazrat Umar Farooq and said to him that if he would accept Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wishes to marry Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala was overjoyed. Extremely happy. Imagine who better a son-in-law than Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And immediately he accepted the proposal that came from Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha does not become the wife of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq or Hazrat Uthman, but better than everyone, subhanallah, who is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she is now included from amongst the Azwaj Mutahharat radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Now again, very quickly, this was not something that was a choice for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rather, Allah's Nabi was never given a choice when it came to choosing for himself. Everything was done for Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam min janibillah, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, even the children, the daughters that were married, this is also min janibillah. And inshallah, this will be understood. When he married Bibi Khadijatul Kubra, of course, she was a lady who was the mother of nearly all the children of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when she passed away, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given an option to marry Sauda or Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. And at that time, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq's desire was that Hazrat Aisha should marry Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he was trapped between the Arab culture. The Arabs, the pagan system at that time was that if anyone, even an honorary title was given to someone that he is my brother, that he is my brother, that would even bar and restrict him from marrying that person's daughter or for his daughter to marry the other person. So now it was well known in Arabia that Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were very, very close, and at times he even said that he is my brother. So Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq felt that there is never a possibility that my daughter, because of their custom, Hazrat Aisha could ever marry Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, initially she was meant to marry Hazrat Jubair ibn Mut'im. Hazrat Aisha was to marry Jubair ibn Mut'im. These were the words that the Mu'arikheen have mentioned, and this is how it was said. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had taken Hazrat Sauda, who was very mature and much older in age, so that she could even look after the children that Hazrat Khadija al-Kubra had left behind. So Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Hazrat Sauda, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted Allah's great Nabi to have relationship, qarabaddari, relationship with two of his closest companions and his two sincere assistants, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar Farooq. And therefore, it was the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that after Hazrat Sauda, in close succession, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was told to marry Hazrat Aisha and then also to marry Hazrat Hafsa. Baat sunnahi? So he married Hazrat Aisha and he also married Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala. Now, this was something that was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was not a choice given to him. Everything was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was min janibillah. There was no choice for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed for Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And these were the Azwaj Mutahara. So Bibi Khadija al-Kubra had passed away. You had Hazrat Sauda, and then you had Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and then you had Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also married other women. Going back to Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anha, after the demise of Hazrat Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha, again, this was a difficult moment for him. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called Hazrat Ayman. Now inshallah, in our session today, there are certain women who have been mentioned in our topic that we are covering, and it would only be fair for us to explain what high status they hold in the Sharia and how close they were to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hazrat Ayman was told to beat the duff, to beat the duff. This was, again, the duff was generally played when there was a nikah that was to take place. So this was an indication that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted the middle daughter, Hazrat Kulsoom, to also marry Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala. So Hazrat Ruqayya had passed away, and Hazrat Ayman was preparing Hazrat Kulsoom. She was younger than Hazrat Ruqayya, but older than Bibi Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha. And she came in the nikah of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anha. Now this nikah was also somewhat very, very unique. It is said that when Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anha married Hazrat Kulsoom, there is a hadith narrated by Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anha. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Uthman, Ya Uthman, Hada Jibreel, that this is Jibreel, Akhbarani anna Allah ta'ala kad zawwajaka bi Umme Kulsoom. Kad zawwajaka bi Umme Kulsoom. That I can see Jibreel Amin, and Jibreel Amin comes to me and tells me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already decided for Uthman to marry Kulsum. And Allah has married both of them. Now imagine, my respected brothers, what honor is this? That after Hazrat Ruqayya passes away, Jibreel Amin is saying that Allah has already decreed that Uthman is now married to Hazrat Kulsum. And that is why the words are such that no choice was either given to Hazrat Uthman, but Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a very blunt statement to Hazrat Ayman. Get her prepared because she is now going to get married to Hazrat Uthman. And Hazrat Uthman was also told that this was something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. These are great virtues of certain individuals. In fact, even for one of the wives of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, two wives were named as Hazrat Zainab. I refer to Hazrat Zainab bint Jahash. Hazrat Zainab bint Jahash. It comes in the Quran also, she is mentioned. She was the cousin sister of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was married first to Hazrat Zaid radiallahu ta'ala, and then in Surah Al-Ahzab this is explained that it didn't work out. There was this bitter relationship between the two, and Hazrat Zainab was divorced from Hazrat Zaid radiallahu ta'ala. Then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married the cousin sister, Hazrat Zainab bint Jahash radiallahu ta'ala anha. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا قَضَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا وَتَرًا زَوَّجْنَاكَهَا. Allah says that I have already made the nikah of Zainab with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the nikah is already done. So this was a nikah that was done up in the heavens. That is why many a time, if somebody was to say that, oh Zainab, how fortunate you are that your family members got you married to Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she would say, no, no, no. Allah got me married to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the heavens. Ulama have mentioned that perhaps she is the only woman who got married without any witnesses and any wakil. Musa bhai, when you got married, was there a wakil?
Yeah.
You remember him? You remember him?
No, I don't remember.
Okay, you don't remember it. You know how much mahar you gave?
20 pounds.
20 pounds. He was a rich. He's always been rich. Musa bhai has always been rich. Mashallah.
But my wages were 20 pounds for a whole year.
Okay. So mashallah. Right. I'll do the speaking now, Musa bhai. So what had happened? She is the only lady who got married without witnesses. Without witnesses, without a wakil. Now according to the mas'ala, if a lady is present, then you don't need the wakil, someone who's representing the woman. So if a lady is behind a veil somewhere, and if the imam or the qazi was to say that, do you give me permission and that you want to marry this individual who is in front of me, and if she says yes, that is enough. So you don't need a wakil, but for nikah you need two witnesses. But nowadays, because it's difficult for a woman to come to the masjid, and again this is another masla for those who enforce women to become imams and to allow them to be committee members so that they can rule over the imams and say, ah, Mauli Sahab, this is how you do the ruku and sujood. It would be quite a difficult time for the ummah if this is accepted. Even in nikah, it has always been the tradition that there is always a wakil for a lady because of this concept of parda that has to be maintained. Alhamdulillah, if a lady wishes to come to the masjid and say, that is fine. That is fine. If there is a facility provided and women come, no haraj. But again, everything in moderation is accepted in Sharia. Everything in moderation is accepted in Sharia. So Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got married to Hazrat Zainab. This was a nikah that was arranged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without a wakil, without anybody there, and the nikah was done. So this similar pattern occurred with the daughter of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Kulsum radiallahu ta'ala anha. and subhanallah, it was the decision arranged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Hazrat Uthman to marry Hazrat Kulthum. Subhanallah, Hazrat Kulthum lived with Hazrat Uthman radiallahu ta'ala until her death. Eventually, she also passed away because of an illness. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam this time was present. During the time of Hazrat Ruqayyah, he was in jihad. But this time, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there. All the arrangements and preparation for burial, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself performed. And it is said that for the body to be lowered down in the grave, Hazrat Abu Talha, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, Hazrat Zaid bin Harisa, and Hazrat Fadl ibn Abbas, these were the companions who were in the grave, making sure that when the body is put down, it is done without giving any difficulty to Hazrat Kulthum. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that time it was extremely difficult for Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again, let us not forget, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after all, was a human being. But the best from all of the human beings. He was a human being, of course. You can't deny that. And he had the same feelings to a certain extent. Though that level of character, of course, cannot be compared with anything in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he showed a lot of remorse, and Allah's Nabi was extremely saddened at the death of Hazrat Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala. And he looked at Hazrat Uthman and said, Uthman, now I have no daughters. Hazrat Fatima was already married to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. But if I had daughters, I would have married them to you, O Uthman. Ulama have mentioned that the ladies who gave ghusl, bathed Hazrat, the body of Hazrat Kulthum, Hazrat Asma bint Umais, Hazrat Asma bint Umais, Hazrat Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib, she was the auntie of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Hazrat Ayman. Remember, Hazrat Ayman was also the lady who had prepared Hazrat Kulthum, and she's also there now. According to the narration, she performed ghusl, and she was also that lady who gave ghusl to Hazrat Khadijatul Kubra. So she gave ghusl to the mother of Kulthum, Bibi Khadija, and she gave ghusl to Hazrat Kulthum. Hazrat, let us talk about each of these individuals very, very quickly, my respected brothers. Hazrat Asma bint Umais. Hazrat Asma bint Umais. Asma is a good name, mashallah. A lot of people ask that what names they should keep. And you will find a lot of the names. Aisha, Maryam, mashallah, Kulthum, as we speak. Subhanallah, these are good names. Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib, the auntie of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was the sister of Hazrat Maymuna. Asma bint Umais was the sister of Hazrat Maymuna, who was the wife of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. An incredible lady. Incredible lady. She was married to Hazrat Ja'far. Who was she married to? The son of Abu Talib. She was married to Hazrat Ja'far. When Hazrat Ja'far became shaheed, she married Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Umar, are you listening? She married Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. When Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq passed away, she married Hazrat Ali. So imagine who this lady is, that she married actually senior companions of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First she married Hazrat Ja'far, he was made shaheed, then she married Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, and then he passed away, then Hazrat Ali, and it stopped. It was said that, well, anybody who marries Hazrat Asma, there's a possibility he goes quickly. Khair, this was again just on a lighter note, my respected brothers. But this is Hazrat Asma bint Umais radiallahu ta'ala. What a lady she was. And then we talk about Hazrat Safiya bint Abdul Muttalib. It is said about her that she was a brave, strong, courageous lady. Very strong. A fighter. It comes in the hadith, during the battle of the trench, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gathered all the women and he secluded them one side in a camp. And poor Hassan bin Thabit was given this responsibility of guarding the women. Hazrat Hassan bin Thabit was someone into the Arabic linguistics and the words and the grammar. This was his job. He was a poet. He was a poet. And so Allah's Nabi said, right, Hassan, you look after the women and just make sure. Hassan bin Thabit was a soft-hearted man. He would read Shairi and everything that was there. But he played a very important role in jihad, making sure, giving strength to the companions by reading such poetry that all of a sudden, subhanAllah, would spark up energy and strength in the hearts of the companions. So this man was pivotal also in jihad. But at this time he was looking after women. Now there was this Jewish man prowling around everywhere and looking at Muslim women, and Hazrat Safiya quickly looked. Who is this man? He's not Hassan bin Thabit, not a Muslim. He's a Jewish man. So she shouts at Hassan, "Ya Hassan, there's a man here. There's a man here, Hassan." Hassan says, "He's not here to do anything. He's not here to do." He was a Jewish man. And Hazrat Hassan did not show any concern. So when she looked at Hazrat Hassan is not too involved with what's happening, she took a stick and she said, "I'll sort him out." She came out and she said to the Jewish man, "Do you want to fight me? Do you want to?" And she is the auntie of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This Jewish man really had bad intention. And he was there with the intention, aliyazu billah, to even kill the Muslim women that were there in one location, or even to set fire to the tents. But Hazrat Safiya, she was so strong, it is said that she stood up and she fought with this Jewish man. Eventually she overpowered him and killed him. And when she killed him, this man was cold, dead in front of Hazrat Safiya. And then she said to Hazrat Hassan, "Hassan, now come. Hassan, now come." He says, "What has happened?" He says, "He's dead. But because he's a man, I can't lift the body. We want you to get rid of this man from us." Allahu Akbar. This was the jazbah. This was the power and strength with Muslim women. Very, very courageous. MashaAllah. And this is what we need today also. Women who are also physically very, very strong, but not to do bodybuilding, huh? Just physically making sure that everything is toned up well, but not to go to extreme in moderation, but to be courageous and also to be very, very strong. Finally, we come to Hazrat Ayman. This lady was an incredible woman. She was the carer of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam after the demise of Hazrat Amina radiallahu ta'ala anha. When she passed away, she looked after Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Few ladies from the women have this reputation and this title that Allah's Nabi has titled them to be the for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the mother of Rasulullah. And Ayman radiallahu ta'ala anha is one from them. Only a few. And so Hazrat Ayman was actually considered to be like the mother figure for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Such a lady that once Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in a gathering and Hazrat Ayman was passing. And so Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "If anybody wants to see a lady from Jannah, then look at Ayman."
MashaAllah.
Anybody wants to see a lady from Jannah, then look at Ayman. She was an old lady. Hazrat, not old as in very old, and Hazrat Ayman was walking past. And then Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Let me tell you, whoever marries her will also go in Jannah."
Allah.
Whoever marries her will also go in Jannah. She is in Jannah, but whoever marries her will also go in Jannah. Hazrat Zaid bin Harisa jumped up. Without looking at her, without even thinking of anything else, you know, just Jannah here, wholesale Jannah. رسول الله أحل قطعة يا رسول الله. زيد بن هارثة. Now Hazrat Zaid bin Haritha was a slave. Allah's Nabi had purchased him at the bazaar of Uqaz and then emancipated him, gave him his freedom. He was actually known as Zaid bin Muhammad before.
Mm-hmm.
But then when the verses were revealed, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, that you should not attach your name with that person who is not your biological father.
Okay.
When the verses were revealed, that is the time he was then known as Zaid ibn Harisa. Ulama have mentioned because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoled him. He is the only Sahabi, because at one point he was a slave and everyone knew to him to be the son of Rasulullah, though adopted, but to be the son of Rasulullah.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of a sudden, because of the verses, he was cut off from this privilege. Allah honored him that he is the only Sahabi in the Quran mentioned by name. The only Sahabi. فَلَمَّا قَضَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا, in the 22nd para, Surah Al-Ahzab. The only Sahabi. So this man got married to Hazrat Umm Ayman. So the nikah was done. Now Hazrat Zaid was very handsome, white in complexion. But Hazrat Umm Ayman was quite dark in complexion. So it was, he was very handsome and she was dark in complexion. And from Hazrat Zaid, Allah blessed them with a son whose name was Hazrat Usama. Hazrat Usama, not bin Laden, huh? Hazrat Usama bin Zaid. Now everyone knew that Usama is the son of Hazrat Zaid. But the munafiqeen that were there accused Hazrat Zaid. And they said, look, Usama is not the son of Zaid. Zaid is an Arab, very handsome, white in complexion. We don't think that Usama is the son of Hazrat Zaid, because Hazrat Usama was quite dark in complexion and the features were also very different from Hazrat Zaid. So this was something that gave a bit of trouble to Hazrat Zaid and also to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he was known as the Hubbun Nabi, that he was the Muhib of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Hazrat Usama. And then in Arabia at that time, you had certain individuals who, the people were very superstitious and they had a lot of faith with some of these psychic minded people who would come. And there was this man who had a lot of experience and he was psychic minded in determining family relationship. So he came to Madinatul Munawwara and he would say, this child belongs to that person, he is related there, he is the cousin of that person, he is that, he is that. You'll find some people face reading, that by looking at your face they'll tell you what happened. They'll look at your eyes and they'll say that right, this man is related to that person. They'll look at some part of your body and they can actually open up for you your family tree. So this man had come. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam already knew and had said that Usama is the son of Hazrat Zaid. So what Hazrat Zaid and Hazrat Usama did is that in order to test that individual and also a lot of the hypocrites that were there, Hazrat Zaid and Hazrat Usama, both father and son, came in front of that person covering their faces. And in front of an audience they said that, right, can you tell us whether these two individuals are related? And the only body part that was exposed was the feet section. Pair hi khule the bas, nothing else. Now, Hazrat Zaid had a very white complexion and Hazrat Usama was very dark. So you had the munafiqeen that were there and this man looked at the feet of Usama and looked at the feet of Zaid. And he said, no, all of you are wrong. This feet belong to those feet. As in what he was saying is that the feet of Usama are part of the feet of this individual. And he said that, to my best understanding, he is the father and he is the son. And when this chadar veil was lifted, it was exactly as what he had said. He said that Hazrat Zaid was the father of Hazrat Usama. This was when all of the Munafiqeen had no choice but to accept that Hazrat Usama is the son of Hazrat Zaid. So she was Hazrat Ayman. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam dearly loved her. And many a times it is said that Allah's Nabi would even joke with her. And Allah's Nabi's joking was in a complete truth form.
Mm-hmm.
Everything what he would say and what he would utter was nothing but the truth. So once she came and she said, Ya Rasulullah, can you give me a camel as a means of conveyance for me so I can sit and travel? So Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I will give you the child of a camel. I will give you. So she thought, what will I do with a baby camel? And Allah's Nabi said, I'll give you a child of a camel. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, this will not serve my purpose. I need to sit, I need to travel from one part of Medina to another part. And so Allah's Nabi started laughing with Ayman, mother figure. And said, Allah's Nabi said, isn't every camel that you see the child of another camel?
Huh?
So you can be 50 and say that, and a mother might say that, Ye mera beta, this is my dear son, little son, whatever, and he's 50 years of age. Fine. So this was a joke of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but subhanAllah, how true he was. How true he was. And many incidents have occurred. It is said that once Ayman had prepared food, and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was there. And she came and she said, Ya Rasulullah, eat. Allah's Nabi said, no, I won't eat. Eat. I won't eat. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would laugh and look at Ayman. She would force Allah's Nabi to eat, and Huzur alayhi salam would say, I won't eat. I won't eat. Ulama have mentioned the reason why he did not eat was because Allah's Nabi was fasting. But she did not realize. But the love she had for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that she cared for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam throughout his life, from Bibi Khadijatul Kubra until the very end. In fact, she stayed alive during the Khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar, and Hazrat Abu Bakr and Umar would personally go and visit her, just like how Allah's Nabi would visit her, and showed all the respect to Ayman. These are just some of the incredible women mentioned in the ahadith and the seerah of Hazrat Uthman bin Affan radiyallahu ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa maulana Muhammadin nabil ummi wa ala alihi wa sallim taslima. Allahumma taqabbal minna wa tub alayna innaka anta tawwabur rahim. Astaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Sami'na wa ta'ana ghufranaka rabbana wa ilayka al-masir. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.